then the third thing in computer literacy is that for anything that we can be literate in, there is a literature. So when we read Shakespeare, we have to read Shakespeare with a completely different approach to the genre of the Elizabethan age than we do from reading Mickey Spillane. So throughout the many centuries in which the English language has existed, there are different genres that we have to be able to adapt to. And that's the third form of literacy, is genre literacy. In this talk, I'm concentrating mostly on the first two. And now I want to go and focus on why this stuff works and how we came to some of these design decisions. Of course, some of it was just haphazard and random. Some of it we rationalized after the fact. But some of it, we actually thought it through and were able to use stuff that had been done before. So give you an idea of how difficult it is to understand how the mind works. Let's take a look at this slide and see if we can see what's wrong with it. If you look at it for a while, you'll see that the mouth is somehow upside down. And maybe the eyes, something wrong with the eyes. Maybe they're upside down, too. And if I were teaching in a school and trying to teach you about what had been done with this slide, I would say an English sentence like the following. I'd say, well, here we've taken a slide of a young girl, extracted her eyes and mouth, and put them back in with an airbrush, and then turned the entire slide upside down. That's an English sentence. And now that I've said that, you can understand everything about what it looks like when I turn it right side up. Now, I've given this talk many times, and I'm going to have to move it backward because I've discovered nobody will listen to me when that slide is on. And from the many times I've given the talk, I know that there were gasps in the classroom when you saw that picture because you weren't prepared for it, even though I told you everything about what had been done to it. Now, perceptual psychologists really love when something like this happens because it means that information going in through one channel, the auditory channel to your language processing centers, elicited one kind of response to my sentence. And when you saw the actual picture through your visual channel, it elicited a completely different response. And this is actually understood physiologically as well as psychologically. On the under right-hand side of your brain, where you do face recognition, there are two pieces of brain tissue about an inch apart. One of them is an expert at faces. It's a thing that allows you to see faces in clouds, the thing that scares children in twilight. They see menacing shadows. And it's reporting right now, I see an upside-down face-like thing. Then about an inch away is another piece of brain tissue that's an expert in eyes and eyes and mouth only. And it's saying, well, that's a good-looking mouth, and those are okay eyes. There's very little dissonance between the reports of these two separate pieces of brain tissue. Now, when I go to this right-side-up version of the thing, the face recognition guy is saying, well, that's a right-side-up face-like thing. And the eyes and mouth guy is saying, something is terribly wrong here. And you can imagine why nature might have arranged for you to be startled. Seeing a face like this up close might mean you're going to die in the next 10 seconds. And in fact, it is built into all mammals, something that we don't learn but is in the mammalian nervous system. So if you try this on a dog, I suggest you pick a small one. So the basic idea here is that what we think of as the unitary I, the unitary I-ness of I, myself, and me, is really a multiple set of different mentalities that apparently came about during different evolutionary periods. The mentalities think differently. They don't communicate very well with each other. They're often in conflict, and only a few of them talk. So we're only aware of a few of them in what we call our consciousness. Most of what the other mentalities do we call our subconscious. But relegating everything to the subconscious is almost akin to mysticism. And in fact, there's a lot more to be learned about this area. And we got interested in three of these mentalities, first from the work of Jean Piaget. And Piaget said that children and adults have a unitary mentality that goes through stages as the child matures. So Piaget said, first there is a doing stage where a hole is to dig it, and an object is to grab it. Thinking is action in that stage. The child doesn't think ahead. He doesn't imagine the consequences of his action. He just does. Later image stage, child of 5 or 6 or 7, who, for instance, when given a squat glass poured into a tall, thin glass, will say there's more water in the tall, thin glass. I think everybody is familiar with the with that experiment of Piaget's. It's because the child is being dominated by the visual image. It looks like there's more water there, and so the visual logic says that there is. And then around 11 or 12, Piaget says that the child goes to a facts and logic stage, away from the immediacy of the visual environment, or at least in Swiss-French children who are 11 and 12. There are less evidence that American children ever get into the facts and logic stage. Now, when we looked at Piaget's theory, it was interesting. What it seemed to say is that if the child is below the age of 5, say, you should only do muscular things, and if the child is in this age between, say, roughly 5 and 11, that you should do mostly visual things, and then above that, you should do sort of symbolic things. And it just didn't come through with any ideas for us. But while reading about Piaget, we had found the work of Brunner, who is the American psychologist who was one of the persons to bring Piaget to the American public's attention. And Brunner had a more interesting theory, and it came about from experiments that he did to confirm what Piaget was talking about. So Brunner did the experiment, took the water in the squat glass and poured it into the tall, thin one. The child said, yes, there's more water in the tall, thin glass. And then Brunner did something that Piaget hadn't thought to do. Brunner then covered up the glass. And the child said, oh, but wait, there must be the same amount of water because where would it go? And then Brunner revealed the tall, thin glass, and the child said, oh, wait, no, look, there's more water. And Brunner covered it up again, and the child said, oh, there must be the same amount of water because where would it go? So if you have any 9-year-olds you'd like to torment, this is a good way to do it, because what Brunner was doing was jumping the child not from this mentality back to a previous stage, but he was showing, as he did in many experiments, the existence of multiple mentalities. So the child was normally visually dominant here, but if you occluded the visual field, then this fledgling symbolic mentality that was really going to be switched on in a stronger way later on could actually work. And from this, we got a lot of ideas. It suggested that there are ways of using some of these other mentalities. And we got some confirmation from some interesting work in the literature of creativity. One of them was by Jacques Hadamard, the famous French mathematician, who in the late stages of his life decided to poll his 99 buddies, the other who made up together the 100 great mathematicians and physicists on the earth. And he asked them, how do you do your thing? And they were all personal friends of his, so they wrote back depositions. And only a few out of the 100 claimed to use mathematical symbology at all. It was quite a surprise. All of them said they did it mostly in imagery or figurative terms. And an amazing 30% or so, including Einstein, were down here in the mud pies. Einstein's deposition said, I have sensations of a kinesthetic or muscular type. Einstein could feel the abstract spaces he was dealing with in the muscles of his arms and his fingers. So one way of interpreting Hadamard's diagram here is the genius is the ability to recapture childhood at will. That's sort of the Piagetian way of looking at it. But a stronger way is to look at it through Brunner's eyes and see that what is actually going on is that these very creative people are somehow able to be in contact with other mentalities that are going on all the time. Now, this is a better way of thinking about this than simply splitting things up into conscious and subconscious or right brain and left brain. This notion that there are each one of these things evolved for a different reason and can do different kinds of logics is very important. And we'll see why in a second. Now, I'm going to give you the most graphic demonstration I know of this principle in action, of what it means to actually be able to teach directly to the mentality that's going to learn rather than trying to teach through an inappropriate channel. You see, the sad part of Hadamard's diagram is that every child in the United States is taught math and physics through this channel, the channel that almost no adult creative math mathematician and physicist uses to do it. And that is really a shame. They use this channel to communicate, but not to do their thing. And much of our education is founded on those principles, that just because we can talk about something, there is a naive belief that we can teach through talking and listening. Now, this example I'm going to show is taken from a television show in 1975 on Harry Reasoner's television show on ABC. And he had read a book that apparently upset him called The Inner Game of Tennis, which basically said almost anybody can learn to play a decent game of tennis in just a single afternoon if you don't try too hard. And that had made him wonder, because he'd been trying to play tennis for many years. And so he sent an ABC news squad out to California to expose this charlatan. And what they did was to round up a number of people and get them to sign legal affidavits saying that they had never played tennis before. They took them all out in the court and picked the worst one, who happened to be a 55-year-old lady, 40 pounds overweight, 5'2", in a muumuu. And she had the muumuu because her deposition said that not only had she never played tennis, but she'd not even exercised in 20 years. So taking them all on the court, turning on the live TV cameras, they set a clock and said to Tim Galway, you have 20 minutes to teach her how to play tennis. Now let's look at this from the standpoint of user interface design. Because in every way, Tim Galway is the user interface of this interactive teaching situation we have. And let's see what he actually does.
I'm going to have Tim hit some balls
to me.
And as the ball flies through the air, I want you just to watch it. In the very instant the ball hits the court, I want you to say bounce. In the very instant the ball hits the racket, I want you to say hit. So you'll just be saying bounce, hit. All you need to do is watch the ball, okay?
Bounce.
The key of all the exercises in the inner game is to focus the mind's attention somewhere where it will not interfere with the body's ability to hit the ball automatically.
You stand here and Tim will throw you a couple, and you just continue doing the same thing.
Should I try to hit it?
Not at first. At first, just say bounce when the ball bounces and hit when you would hit it, but don't hit it. Then after you feel like hitting it, go ahead and hit it.
Okay.
Now, you might watch your right arm here.
Hit.
Bounce, something's trying to hit that ball, bounce, even though she was told that she didn't have to. Now she actually tries, she misses.
When he says bounce, he's also out of the corner of his eye watching me hit the ball. So even though he's not trying to see how I hit it, the image of me hitting it is going right into his memory. You enjoying yourself?
Yeah, it's really fun.
You like that? Okay, here we go.
I love it.
The cardinal principle in any book written on tennis, about tennis, is to watch the ball. No tennis player really sees the ball enough. And the reason is they get bored. So I try to give them something to see in the ball that's interesting. So we watch the trajectory of the ball, the gracefulness of the line made by the ball that flies through the air. Always it's the same. Put the mind somewhere where it can stay calm and not get you uptight, but relaxed and interested. Then the body does so beautifully, so beautifully. I might start listening to the ball, Molly. Listen to how it sounds on your racket. Hear that?
Yes.
Hear that one? What did that sound like?
Very dull.
It was like wood. How wood sound. Keep listening and you'll hear the sound that you like pretty soon. Just listen to it. Okay, now listen on this side. Not a girl. Okay. Now, be aware that racket is part of your arm. That's it. Just feel it. Don't try so hard and let it happen. That's it. Do what's comfortable, Molly.
Every time I did start to think, things went wrong. When you just stop thinking, the body seems to know what to do.
Can you feel with your left hand where it is? That a girl.
one's called the serve. And the serve is just like a dance. You just like a dance. We'll come back here and I'll show you how to do a dance called the serve. Okay? And I've done this dance a little bit, so I'll just do it. Okay. Ta-da. In fact, you can start humming if you want. The rhythm, like this. That's it. Da da da. Da da. Out loud. Da da. Okay. Now, here's what you do. Once you stand there, shut your eyes. Shut your eyes, and imagine yourself doing that same dance. You might start humming a little bit. Da da. As you're doing it, yeah. Okay, now what I want you to do is no thinking, just go do it, quick. Just no thinking, just go serve, yeah. Serve,
what?
Fine, don't worry about missing. Keep serving, keep, don't think. Go, do, quick, that's it.
Stop.
Fine, again, don't worry about hitting it.
Stop.
Out loud, let's hear it. Out loud, the rhythm.
Stop.
There you go. I get them to hum the rhythm of my serve. So they're not thinking, oh, this is what he's doing with his elbow, this is what he's doing with his hands. Out loud. Rhythm. There you go. I get them to hum the rhythm of my serve. So they're not thinking, oh, this is what he's doing with his elbow, this is what he's doing with his hands. They're not trying to remember all that. They start humming. And they see themselves doing very similar things, muscular movements, to what I did. But they're not thinking about it. So it just comes out naturally and fluidly. So that didn't take long. That's called serving. Okay, that's your first point in tennis. Score is 15 love.
Fantastic.
Okay, Molly. No need for you to miss.
All of a sudden, everything became effortless. I was just sort of like floating along, you know, and doing what came naturally, you know. And I said, I'm playing tennis. You know, it's really, really beautiful.
Have a clear idea of what you want, then let it happen. Don't try too hard. I'm going to try to make you miss, Molly, because it's going on too long. So I'll just get a little bit harder. You just keep watching the ball. Keep watching it. They're rooting for you, Mom. Don't be distracted. Keep on that ball.
Well, when I saw that, I said something akin to holy cow, because I'd just seen something that I wouldn't have believed possible, and I realized that it applied very strongly to user interface design, that something really important was going on here. So I got Tim Galway's book, The Inner Game of Tennis, and I read it, and a number of things that he said really stuck in my mind. First one was almost a cliche. He said, learning happens when attention is focused. But he was able to get something out of that. Because if you don't have a good theory of learning, then you can still get it to happen by just helping the person focus. One of the ways you can help a person focus is by removing interference. And a lot of what you saw in that tape was a way of holding focus of the mentality that actually had to learn to play the tennis and removing interference from the mentality that likes to talk and make comments. Another thing that Tim said that's particularly stuck in my mind was, he said the problem with most theories of teaching is that the parts of the body you want to have learned don't understand English. So the part of your mentality that understands English doesn't play tennis, can't play tennis, can't do mathematics, it can't do music. What it can do is talk and comment. And so in general, for learning most things, it is good to find a way of short-circuiting that mentality that we think of as the I that always tries to take over. And finally, Tim made a very interesting observation, and that is that the problem with being a beginner is that you get a lot of practice in staying a beginner. So a beginning tennis player most of the time does chase the ball. They get to be really good at chasing the ball, but all other forms of tennis involve hitting the ball. So it's very important for Tim to find a way of catapulting anybody learning tennis, like Molly there, out of the chase a ball stage and instantly get into hitting the ball stage. So he had to find a way of getting a person who had never picked up a tennis racket before to be able to hit the ball 98% of the time they swung at it. We realized that was an incredibly important principle for user interface design. Why spend 2 weeks trying to read an MS-DOS manual to see how to copy a file or open up an application? Why do any of those things? What do you get from it? Much better to find a way of designing the user interface so that the person who uses it acts like an intermediate from the first time that they sit down, and then they get into a process that is rewarding in itself. Now, these ideas work beautifully for music, and they also apply in cognitive areas very strongly. Here's an example of a programming problem, and that is, let's take the logo turtle and write a program to draw a circle. And we'll do it with three ages of people, a 5-year-old, a 10-year-old, and a 15-year-old, as representatives from these three mentality dominant areas, the body, the visual, and the symbolic. Now, the way you get a 5-year-old to do a picture, to do a circle, is something that Seymour Papert learned long ago, and that is you tell the 5-year-old, close your eyes and make a circle with your body. After they've gone partway around, you say, well, what were you doing? And the 5-year-old says, well, I was going a little and turning a little over and over again. If you type that into logo, you get a perfect circle. And that's because the 5-year-old knows differential equations. Because the circle is a particularly simple thing in differential geometry, which was only discovered about 150 years ago by Carl Gauss. So a circle is that thing that has constant curvature, so the change in curvature is zero. And the child's body mentality, doing mentality, understands that kind of geometry. So the 5-year-old comes up with a very simple program that produces an elegant circle. The 10-year-old has a harder time, because a 10-year-old is visual and really wants to look at things. He doesn't want to do things with his body so much anymore. And so he wants to draw circles with a compass. And after a while, he'll see that by drawing lots of circles, he'll see that the main thing about drawing circles with a compass is that the points on the rim are always the same distance from the center. So his turtle program picks the pen up, starting in the center, jumps out to the rim, goes 100 there, puts the pen down, makes a mark, picks the pen up, backs to the center, turns 1 degree, and does that over and over again. So it's chugga 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 chug, and you get a perfect circle. Much harder way of doing it, but still a good circle. And of course, I wouldn't be telling this story if the 15-year-old were able to get a circle at all, because like most adults, he's in the facts and logic stage, and he knows the most horrible fact thought up by the mind of man, which is x squared plus y squared equals r squared. A very bad coordinate system, and even if it were a good coordinate system, it has very little operational significance. So here we see an example of just concentrating on different mentalities in people's skulls, getting vastly different results in doing the program, and surprisingly, the age levels that are supposed to do less well actually do better. And this led to a slogan I made up, which is the point of view is worth 80 IQ points. So in other words, if you're in 60 BC in Rome trying to multiply two numbers together, you had to be a genius to be able to remember all the partial products that Roman numerals generated. If you're in 1300 AD wondering where Mars is going to go, you had to be a genius to be able to figure out all of the Ptolemaic epicycles. So it's not logic that is powerful. Logic is actually a weak method because it depends on fragile chains of inference. And people have used logic throughout history, but mostly in inappropriate contexts. There's nothing illogical about the way the alchemists or the Babylonians did things. It was that they were in a context in which their logic couldn't do much. So this notion that the context is powerful, and if you want want to be able to be good at solving problems and acting much smarter than you are, then you have to find a context that is going to do most of the thinking for you. Most computer scientists know this because it goes under another heading of called choose the appropriate data structure before you start tinkering around with the algorithm. Do the right data structure, you will have most of the result computed almost automatically as part of its inherent structure. All that reminds me of Edward De Bono's famous comment about American business. I think it probably applies to American universities also. He said, the problem with American business is when it gets in trouble, it redoubles its efforts. And he likened this to if you have a bunch of people digging for gold in a certain spot, they get down 5 feet and they don't find any gold. One of the ways they could do to resolve their problem is to dig twice as hard. And of course, if the gold is 20 feet over to the side, then they can dig all the way to China without finding it out. And the important idea here is that problem solving, all of these things have more than one dimension, and a lot of the important dimensions for doing thinking lie along the lines of these different mentalities. And that led to another slogan, which said, well, gee, we don't know how to choose between these Brunnerian mentalities. The kinesthetic one is very valuable, knows where things are. The image one is tremendously valuable because it gives you a way of picking things out of a conglomeration very easily. It's quite a bit more efficient to pick an image from a bulletin board than to pick an item out of a linear list of symbols. And the symbolic one, of course, is very powerful given the right context because it can do inferencing that is not open to these other mentalities. So we thought that the right slogan would be, well, gee, why can't we find some way of tying these together? And the way we did it was to say, well, one way of involving the kinesthetic mentality is to give you something to point with. So we have the mouse there not just because it's good to point to the screen occasionally, but because it involves the kinesthetic sense. And the kinesthetic sense is the one that knows where you are. It's the one that locates you in space, not your eyes. Your eyes are an extension of that sense. The image one there is for recognition. Here's a good experiment you can try sometime. Get a friend to manipulate cable television movie channels. Go to a random movie and see how many frames it takes before you can say whether you've seen it before. Think of what that means. You may not have seen this movie for 12 or 15 years, and yet after just a few seconds for most people, you can identify that you've seen this movie and usually be able to remember what comes next. Famous experiment by Harman some years ago took 25 or 30 people, showed them 10,000 images spaced 10 seconds apart. So it took hours and hours to show them all these random photographs of things. And even after 30 days, all of the people in the experiment had better than 90% recall on all of the images. So they could say whether an image was one of the set with 90% probability. They could identify occluded portions in the image. An unbelievable feat is performed by this mentality. Tremendous for creativity in lots of different ways. And then this one is the one that allows you to abstract what you've done concretely there. So all of those things should go together, and that was what we tried to do at Park. So here's one of the first versions of this interface, and this is done by Dan Ingalls, who, after I had invented Smalltalk, was the person who did most of the Smalltalk implementation and then became the major designer of Smalltalk. And this was a crystallization of a lot of the ideas that we had all had, culminating around late 1975, around 1976 or so. This is what the Smalltalk user interface looked like. We see collapsed windows up here that when you clicked on them would open back up again, clock, multiple applications, and so forth. Larry Tesler, who's now at Apple, had this idea, and this is called Galley Editor, that documents should be able to have different paragraph types. So you might have a paragraph type of text, you might have a paragraph type that's a picture, and that when you put the mouse into the paragraph, it invoked the editor for what's there. And this is a metaphor that I think is going to overtake the cut and paste metaphor that people are used to today, because it's much better in general to always work in the context of the results you're trying to get. We call it results mode interaction. Here's a later version of this principle done by Bob Flagel. multiple views into the same structure were first done at Xerox PARC by Trygve Reinskaug, a visiting professor from Norway in our group. And he was particularly interested in scheduling. So here is a schedule versus a Gantt chart for looking at the same thing. And you see you selected something here, and the selection shows up here, and it also shows up on this list, and it also shows up down here as a list of names of things. So this idea that what you're actually looking at are different views seen through different filters is something we originally got from Engelbart, but redone in this new form, the multiple window user interface. And here's the way the interface looks today in Smalltalk. And here's just a brief look at what that interface looked like about 10 years ago. What he's doing is actually entering into sort of like a hyperspace window. He's using a pop-up menu there to get a workspace window. Scrolling is on the opposite side from what you're used to on the Macintosh. And you can see that the scroll arrow is position sensitive. The elevator scrolls you through the text, and Smalltalk, anything that you type can also be executed. So if you just type 3+4 in the editing window or pick up something else, you can say do it, and Smalltalk will go off and do it. Here's the state of the painting program as it was almost 10 years ago. These are radio buttons that you could actually control your own features. And one of the wonderful things about giving this talk today is that we're almost at the point where I never have to show this movie again, because most of the things that we had done at PARC in this system are now available on powerful micros like the Apple Macintosh 2. I think the final thing I'll show here is this is a browser structure invented by Larry Tesler, in which when you point to a category area, it retrieves a bunch of related things. So we're looking at all the different kinds of things that we can do arithmetic on, picked integer there, looking at the arithmetic part of things you can do to integers, and looking at the operation plus, and here is the code in Smalltalk to do integer plus. And here is an example of the debugger in the system. We'll type in some nonsense. We'll try and add 3 to a piece of text. A piece of text says this is a string. So as we say do it to that, instead of crashing the system, what we'll do get is a notification here that the string couldn't transform itself into an integer. And here we can look and see what was going on at that time. So all of the processing that was being done in that thread of control was set aside in Smalltalk. And in fact, once people looked on the disk and found 1,700 suspended processes that were just left there during the debugging of the system. Now by expanding that debugging window, we got a picture of things that were happening in that process quite independently of the processes in Smalltalk that are operating the Windows system and the debugging system. So here's the code that was executing here's the attempt of the string to make itself into an integer that failed. It couldn't do that because it couldn't find any numeric characters to transform. And here are the parameters. There's the argument. Self is the thing that got the message, so that's 3. And so we get to see all of the things. We could single step it if we wished. We can restart it if we wished, and so forth. So the whole ideal of what we're trying to do here is comes back to this question that I asked in the very beginning, and that is, what would a computer be if it were like a pencil? Can it be used by children? Well, yes, it can. Can it be used by adults? Yes, it can. How low can we go to childhood? Can we go into much lower than grade school? Here's an answer to that question. It's a tape I got from the woman who's my accountant. This is her daughter, aged 22 months, 2 months shy of her second birthday. And she's never lived in a world that wasn't densely populated with Macintoshes, because both her mother and father worked at home, and both of her mother and father had their own Mac. And in fact, when I found out the little girl was interested in computers, I gave her an Apple II, which she rejected. She wanted a Macintosh just like her folks. And she literally learned to use it by sitting on her mother's lap while her mother was working. So for this child, the Macintosh is not a piece of technology, but simply more material in the environment to manipulate. Though I don't believe in user surveys, the one I did do with this very young user is I discovered that she vastly preferred Macintoshes with installed hard disks. Now, given that she can use the mouse, and some people are surprised that she can without having to look at it, but in fact, it's something that everybody can use, it's not too surprising that she can hit visible menu commands in Mac Paint. So when I saw this, I was intrigued. I'd never seen a child this young interacting with a computer before, but I wasn't too overwhelmed until I saw what she did next. She wants a fresh sheet of paper, so she hits the close bar in the window. She saves her old drawing using the pop-up, and then she uses the pull-down to get herself a fresh sheet, and she's off and running again. And in fact, we discovered that she was about 70% literate. About 70% of the generic window commands that are found in any Macintosh application, she is able to use, not just in a visual program like Mac Paint. So the answer is that this stuff is for all of us, and the reason it works is not because the goodness of computer science in it, although there is some there. The main reason it works is because for some reason we decided to study human beings and involve lots of human beings called children in our experiment and try and stay closely coupled to them for a number of years. And out of that came a bunch of ideas that could not have sprung just from technology alone. So if it weren't for the multiple mentality ideas of Brunner and the catalysis of Tim Galway's Inner Game of Tennis and a host of other sources like Suzuki's Way of Teaching Children Violin and others too numerous to mention, we never would have thought of these ideas and implemented them the way we did. I think a good way of ending this talk is with a Winston Churchill joke, which, all Winston Churchill jokes, he's at a party after a certain number of whiskeys, and no matter what happens, he's always in perfect command of the English language. And in this joke, it's rather early in the evening, and he's over in the corner drinking his scotch, and the hostess of the party comes over to him terribly distraught and says, "Mr. Churchill, I'm really upset. I just saw a famous earl over here steal one of my silver salt shakers. What am I to do?" And Churchill thought for a minute and stuck his cigar in his mouth and went over to the earl, and on the way he picked up a silver salt shaker and put it in his pocket. When he got over to the earl, he took it out and said, "I think we've been noticed. Perhaps we should put these back." So the moral of that, besides that being the reason we won World War II, the moral of that story is if you want people you, you have to involve them in the same conspiracy. And user interface design is a conspiracy that I hope more of you will get interested in. Thank you very much.
I'm Judith Lemon, and our first question is from Rensselaer Polytechnic Institute. Alan, what do you feel about attempts to protect legally fundamental ideas in graphics, especially Apple's attempt to protect the Mac interface, Sutherland's patenting of clipping algorithms?
Well, I think that the basic idea of protecting inventions is something that's been around for a long time, and it has done people who have taken the energy to invent things a fair amount of good. I would like to have a tenth of a cent for every window that opens on a screen for the next 5 years. But I think that even in patent law, there is enormous confusion between what's an idea and what's an invention. Patent law doesn't allow you to patent an idea, even though nowadays ideas are important as inventions that have been made concrete in some fashion. Also, there is a lot of confusion still in what it means to copyright something. When I was at Atari, the earliest statutes that they used as precedent were things that had to do with copyrighting of player piano rolls back in the early 1900s. So it's a very complicated issue. I think that a sort of a first principle in it is if a company spends a lot of money paying people to invent an idea and then comes out with that idea, they should have some protection for it for a while. I don't see any reason why we should condone having those things ripped off. If some company is paying millions of dollars, other companies shouldn't just get it for free. I think beyond that, the situation is pretty much confused.
This question, Alan, comes from the University of Utah. Where will powerful micros take us? First in 5 years, and then in 10 years?
Well, I think the simple answer is probably not far enough. The basic industry is very conservative. Wall Street wants people to stay with the 86 and 68,000 architectures, which I think is a big mistake. There are lots more interesting things on the horizon, and the amount of computer cycles we actually need to do things, particularly that involve interaction, is always grossly underestimated. So I think that the one answer is that the next 5 years, and especially the next 10 years, could be incredibly interesting. Certainly in the 10-year horizon is the possibility of doing real-time 3D graphics at the flight simulator level on a desktop. I believe that could be done within 5 years if companies took a great interest in it. So we're at a very interesting stage now where the cost performance, as I think everybody realized, it doesn't go in a steady curve. It goes in jumps and fits because the major cost in the computer is in the packaging. And every time you can get the number of transistors up by a factor of 10, you have an enormous change in whether you can put a thing on a board or whether it requires a rack or an entire case.
Okay. Again, from the University of Utah, computers have not been a big success in direct teaching, for example, computer-aided instruction. Why is this so, and what can be done to improve it?
Well, I think I'm pretty much, after the experience I've had with working with both children and adults with computers and at least dabbling in the areas of learning and education, I think that the one of the best ways of thinking of a computer is very similar to thinking of what a piano means in teaching music. And the piano can amplify musical impulse. We can only sing with one voice. If we want to play a four-part fugue, we have to use something mechanical like a piano to do it, and it can be done very beautifully. But for most people, the piano has been the biggest thing to turn millions of people away from music for the rest of their lives. And I think the way to sum it up is just to say that all musicians know that the music isn't in the piano. If it were, we'd have to let it vote. And because of that, that says in any situation where education and learning is involved that you first have to develop a curriculum based on ideas, not on media. The media can be amplifiers of those ideas, but you have to have the ideas first. And I think the reason computers have failed is that almost everybody, no matter which way they try and use computers, have wanted the computer to be some sort of magic ointment over the suppurating wound of bad concepts. And I think as soon as people get what we saw is an amazing learning experience in the Tim Galway tennis experience. And And that is something that can extend and be amplified by machines and especially computers. But first you have to have the ideas.
Another University of Utah question.
My old alma mater.
Yes.
Coming through.
What new developments do you see coming for the disabled?
Well, there I think that's a particular interest of mine because my father was a prostheticist and something I've been interested in for many years. And I just wish more people were working on it. The technology is there to do an enormous amount for the 10 million aphasics, as an example. I think there are 20 million people in the United States right now have had strokes. 10 million of them suffer a fair amount of speech impairment. It's quite possible to do technology that they can carry around that allow them to carry on normal conversations about things. Just an enormous set of areas, and I think for people who are interested in user interface, it is another area that gets you out of the McLuhan fishbowl and into a context where you have to go back to first principles and re-examine things. So I think the future there is very bright, but we need more people working in it.
Ellen, whatever happened to Molly?
Molly, yes. Well, it's a wonderful story because after that experience with Tim Galway, she came up, this is in 1975, she came up to him afterwards and said, hey, does this stuff work for weight control? And Tim said, well, gee, I don't know. Let's see if we can figure out something. So they figured out something, and Molly, over the next year, took off all of her weight and became a very good intermediate tennis player, and for the last number of years has run an inner game weight control clinic in Los Angeles. This is a business she set up herself to apply the principles that she'd used to take off all that weight. So this whole experience completely transformed her life. Part of it is she had never thought of herself as being a physical person. She'd never really thought of herself as having a body. And this experience got her in touch with that whole body mentality she'd never been in touch with before. And that's part of the secret of controlling your weight.
Okay, and for the final question, it's two parts. First of all, in terms of increasing human potential, what do you see as the most important challenges for students today?
Well, I think I felt like when I was in college, elementary school all the way through, except for graduate school, I always felt like a guerrilla warrior, where the major task I had was to retain any sense of myself and my own ideas while I was going through this incredible mill of different hurdles other people had set up. And so I think that's number one. Number two, I think, is for any students who are interested in going into science and the engineering, they have to realize that both of those are art forms, and that both of them are sterile exercises without an aesthetic feeling, and that the liberal arts are the best place to develop your aesthetic feeling. So I'm pretty much even against having strong concentrations in engineering, computer science, and those things at the undergraduate level. I think people should try and get a really solid liberal arts background. When I mean solid, I mean of the kind that they would call solid on the continent, not in the U.S., and then use that as an endless well for ideas and metaphors that you can use when you're doing science and engineering. I think anybody who's ever read about famous scientists knows that the strongest connection they have with their work is not technical, but aesthetic. And so finding the aesthetic in yourself and developing the aesthetic in yourself, I think, is the biggest challenge.
And the last part of the question is, what are you setting as your next challenge?
Well, I think for somebody in their 40s, in a field that's only 40 years old or so, has the challenge of, the basic challenge I think that we all have, but especially as we get older, is the challenge of renewal. Renewal, I think, is a very special word, and I like to use it instead of education. Education has strong connotations, but I think renewal is what it's all about. Renewal means always being able to sidle up to a new problem and try and see it from a fresh point of view. And I find as I get older, it is harder and harder to see things from a fresh point of view. And so for me, the kinds of things I need to do are to, for instance, be able to do more music. I used to be a professor. professional musician. I'm still very interested in it. And I find the now that when I have a fair amount of contact with music during the week, that my ideas are fresher in the computer science domain. Otherwise, there's a tendency to just keep on thinking old thoughts and old pathways.
Thank you very, very much. And thank you for joining us today. We invite your comments and questions on this presentation, and we hope that you will make nominations for future speakers and topics. If you're viewing this lecture on tape, we've installed some feedback postcards under the label of the video cassette. If you're not viewing it on tape, our address is at the end of this presentation.